How much workout is too much? Rhabdomyolysis. Meet Armstrong. He's a university student studying at McMaster, and he enjoys going to the gym very much. As the term came to an end, it was officially exam season, and Armstrong was quite stressed out due to all the exam he had. That's why he decided to go to the gym for a nice weightlifting session. When he arrived at the gym, he hadn't gotten enough rest as he was studying for his next exam, but he thought to himself that a bit of workout should make him feel a lot better. Armstrong finished his workout, which consisted of dumbbell pressing, squatting, and plenty of ab workout. He did experience a cramp in his right calf, but after some stretching and rubbing, he went home feeling amazing and was ready to study for his next exam. It wasn't until the next day Armstrong found out that he couldn't straighten his back, and he felt severe soreness and strains on his abs and hips. He was very happy as he thought that the soreness represented his hard work inside the gym. Ever since he got up from his bed, he found himself having trouble in performing most of his activity of daily living. He finally needed to go to the toilet. That's when he started to panic. Armstrong discovered that his urine has turned into a dark Coca-Cola color. Being a life science student, he knew that his urine color was not normal. After doing some quick research on his situation, he suspected that he could be suffering from rhabdomyolysis. He listened to the suggestion online and began to drink lots and lots of water. It didn't take long for Armstrong to feel unexplained fatigueness, dizziness, and numbness in his lower back, which he had never experienced before. He absolutely understood that he needed to go to the hospital in time before he collapsed somewhere, and he was on his way. After arriving at the hospital, a simple blood test showed that Armstrong's creatine kinase level has peaked around 100,000 units per liter, a direct indication that he was suffering from rhabdomyolysis.
Definition and symptoms. According to Stanley M. et al. 2022, rhabdomyolysis occurs when the skeletal muscle undergoes dissolution, so the electrolytes and cell contents of the muscle leak into the extracellular fluid and circulation. Historically speaking, Stanley M. et al. 2022 notes that the disease has been biblically mentioned in the Old Testament, with Israelites experienced similar symptoms of rhabdomyolysis after eating quail in Egypt. The first report of similarly displayed symptoms was in 1812, during the Berlin occupation by the Napoleon Army by a French surgeon called Baron Dominic Jean Larry. Common causes include infections, drugs, trauma, genetic defects, muscle hypoxia, metabolic and electrolyte disorders, according to Stanley M. et al. 2022, and Gupta E. et al. 2021 states that symptoms involve myalgia, weakness, swelling, and dark red urine, which can lead to respiratory failure and changed mental status.
Let's take a look at what would occur in Armstrong's body when he's going through rhabdomyolysis. Firstly, the breakdown of muscle tissues triggers an inflammatory response that activates immune cells. These cells release pro-inflammatory cytokines and enzymes that further damage the muscle fibers. This leads to the release of myoglobin and other muscle proteins into the bloodstream. Myoglobin released in the urine is what makes it so dark brown. The breakdown of muscle fibers also releases intracellular contents such as potassium, phosphorus, and calcium into the bloodstream. These electrolytes are important for muscle function, and their release can lead to electrolyte imbalances, which can cause muscle weakness and cramping. High levels of potassium in the bloodstream can also lead to heart arrhythmias and even cardiac arrest. Myoglobin causes damage to the kidneys by blocking the tubules that filter waste products. This leads to a buildup of waste products in the blood and a decrease in the amount of urine produced. Additionally, the breakdown of muscle tissues also releases other muscle proteins such as creatine kinase and lactate dehydrogenase, which can also cause damage to the kidneys. In severe cases, myoglobin can form clots in the renal tubules, leading to acute tubular necrosis and acute kidney injury. Acute tubular necrosis is a serious complication that can result in permanent kidney damage. Prolonged muscle damage can lead to serious complications, including kidney failure, electrolyte imbalances, and even muscle multi-organ failure. All these processes could be occurring within Armstrong, and it is crucial that he receives prompt diagnosis and treatment of rhabdomyolysis to prevent serious complications and improve recovery outcomes.
Physicians typically need a high index of suspicion and a thorough physical examination and history in order to accurately diagnose rhabdomyolysis. Any patient with known risk factors, including direct traumatic injury, sepsis, muscular disease, and trauma, should be suspected for the disease. However, that being said, the gold standard for laboratory diagnosis is the determination of muscle protein, creatine kinase, in the blood. Although a cutoff threshold for the amount of creatine kinase in the blood has not been determined, a concentration 5 times the upper limit of the normal reference range is used. Creatine kinase levels are the only accurate test for rhabdomyolysis and as a result cannot diagnose an individual for rhabdomyolysis by symptoms alone. A test will indicate rises in creatine kinase levels, which is a factor representing the presence of rhabdomyolysis. Increased amounts of creatine kinase are often released into the blood when there is muscle damage, including skeletal muscle injuries, heart attack, or strenuous exercise. Anybody is susceptible to rhabdomyolysis, but individuals who perform strenuous physical activities and/or work in hot environments are more susceptible. This can include individuals such as endurance athletes who push themselves too hard without resting, firefighters who work in high temperatures, and older individuals who fall and aren't discovered for long periods of time. To add, other risk factors of the disease include high-intensity exercises when your muscles don't have enough time to heal after an intense workout, severe dehydration if you're heating where your kidneys aren't able to dispose of waste without fluids, trauma where your muscle fibers can disintegrate rapidly after undergoing traumatic experiences, medication, drugs and alcohol, and long periods of inactivity. The first plan of action for treatment of rhabdomyolysis is administering fluids and electrolytes intravenously. These IV fluids will flush the toxins from your system and typically individuals administered with IV will need to stay in the hospital for a few days after. After treatment, for more severe cases, physiotherapy will be administered to some individuals in order to help rebuild muscle strength.
Therefore, in order to protect yourself from rhabdomyolysis, make sure you are hydrated, well rested, and have enough calorie intake before you engage in any exercise. Also, be very cautious in pushing over the limit, especially during your first few workouts or the first one in a long time. A famous quote once said, "Little by little, a little becomes a lot." For Armstrong, after his IV treatment, his blood CK level has dropped below 5,000 units per liter, and he is ready to study for his next exam. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe to the channel, Demystifying Medicine McMaster, and check out some of our other content.